But it's very brief. I will say, though, Sof Maaseh B'Machshava Techila, Rabbi Trump and I spent a few months this summer talking about how we could really create a series that enriched and deepened our appreciation of the major figures associated with the explanation of the Torah. And what we've come up with is this fantastic series, which I'm so proud of and very excited about. And I'm especially proud to be associated with Rabbi Trump because I feel that, you know, 30 years from now, when people are watching these YouTubes, they'll say, wow, he was great, but who was that guy who spoke first? I never heard of him. Because Rabbi Trump is like one of those stars on a trajectory of greatness, and I am hoping to ride the coattails of his fame, something like that. Okay, and it doesn't hurt to be named Trump too. That's also useful. No relation. Tonight's topic is the Ramban. Very dramatic life and lots of excitement and a lot of tumult and fascinating material. I am going to just give you a very quick overview of the major events of his life, and then I will turn the microphone and the podium over to Rabbi Trump, who will take us into the texts. So in the first half hour, we'll get a sense of who the Rabbi Nachman ben Moshe was as an individual, and then we will focus on a little bit of what he thought and really get to know the Ramban properly. Okay, so let's start right away. His years are 1194 to 1270. For most of his life, he lived one of quiet, increasing achievement on a scholarly path of greatness, and he was well recognized, well regarded throughout his life as a scholar of international renown, and he lived, you know, a life of shalva. He lived a life of relative ease in one of the greatest places where Jews could live in the 13th century. And then towards the end of his life, when he was already in his 60s and 70s, then he encountered challenges which would have crushed a much younger man, but he steeled himself and was able to rise to two major challenges in his life, both of which we will explore in both parts of this lecture, to really achieve international, or I should say a millennial greatness by what he did in the final two decades of his life. He was known in his lifetime by his contemporaries as Harav HaNe'eman, as the faithful rabbi, meaning the steady, always predictable, always reliable kind of rabbi. He grew up, of course, in Spain, which is always a tremendous exception in Jewish history. The reason why this is so is because the demographic makeup of Spain was radically different from anywhere else in Europe or North Africa or the Middle East. Specifically, from the time of the first exile, the second exile, I should say, in the first century of the Common Era, Jews typically were a tiny minority living in one large majority culture. In the case of North Africa and the Middle East, there were a small community of Jews living amongst a huge majority of Muslims. In Christian Europe, small minority of Jews living in an overwhelming mass of Christians. Especially before the Reformation, they would basically be Catholics and so on. And so that was the kind of binary relationship of Jews to the outside culture. In Spain, however, you had the confluence of three major cultures. You had Muslims, Jews, and Christians. And because neither the Muslims nor the Christians had a lasting, centuries-long hold on that peninsula, as a result, the Jews could parlay that three-way triangular relationship into greater power, and in many cases, stability for the population as a whole. You have these phenomenal figures like Hasta ibn Shaprut, who was a major diplomatic figure in Spain, essentially the Secretary of State of Spain. You have Shmuel ibn Agrela, also known as Shmuel Hanagid, who was one of those exceptional figures who was not only a great intellect, writing a commentary on the Talmud that is still included in Tractate Brachot even to this day, and also a figure figure of great political renown and the commander of the armed forces of one of the nations of Spain. It's hard to imagine, you know, the chief of staff of America, you know, completing Daf Yomi. But that's only a fraction of what Shmuel Ibn Nagrela was, and that's the kind of character that was produced in Spain at that time. And of course, the great eagle, Hanesher HaGadol, the Ramban Maimonides, also stems from this culture. And he, because the Muslims and the Christians were constantly fighting in Spain, the Jews could often use that space between those two cultures to create authority structures for themselves, as we see in the Golden Age of Spain a little bit earlier than this period. So that's when he grew up, and those are the kinds of things that informed the political culture of the day and actually had a major effect on him in particular. His family background was one of really a glorious background. The name, of course, Nachmanides is the Latin for son of Nachman. His first name was Moshe, just like Maimonides, as we've discussed in the past. He actually had a non-Jewish name that's little known. Bonastrog da Porta. I have no idea how they came up with Bonastrog da Porta. I mean, my Hebrew name is Hillel, and my English name is Henry, because they both start with the letter Hey, right? But Nachman and Bonastrog just do not fit one with the other. I think Bonastrog means one day will be a great rabbi.
No.
Actually, I have no idea what it means. I just made that up. Okay. He was a member of a great rabbinic family. His first cousin was Rabbeinu Yonah, and the two families married with each other over many generations. For a career, we only have scattered references, but he apparently acted as a physician, you know, very much like Maimonides. He also achieved greatness as a communal leader, first as a Rosh Yeshiva, and eventually as chief rabbi of Catalonia, a major region of Spain. So a kind of a steady increase towards greatness and leadership throughout his life. Just to look at a couple of episodes in his life, he was a participant in the Maimonidean controversy that we discussed in this room a few months ago. Specifically, when Maimonides was banned by the scholars of France, primarily in the first period of that of the controversy, when it was felt that Maimonides was too infected by Greek philosophy, that his ideas bore too much of an imprint of Aristotle in particular, and as a result he fell under a ban. Later, by the way, in the 13th century, that ban would be somewhat shaped to affect only young men under the age of 25. Over 25, they figured they could handle Maimonides. But at the time, it was raging, and in fact, Maimonides would actually be burned in a square in Paris, Maimonides' books, that is. The Ramban, who in many cases was actually quite a fierce critic of Maimonides in print, or in manuscript more appropriately, he actually came to Maimonides' defense when he saw how imperiled the great eagle's works were in Europe. And he argued that the ban should be somewhat localized. It should only affect seven countries which are known to have the majority Jews. That's all a big joke, and no one is getting it. It's bothering me so much. Thank you. Boaz got it. Okay, all right, thank you. Now, I'm going to have to add a laugh track to this when I edit it. But no, the ban, he argued that the ban should be narrowed to only affect the scholars of France. It should not be extended to Spain. And in this regard, he actually hinted to a major historiographic discussion that would only ensue several centuries later, to the effect that Ashkenazi Jewry and Sephardi Jewry bifurcated around the time of the Crusades. Just to say it very quickly, after the Crusades, which I believe we discussed not too long ago, right, when we talked about Rashi. After the Crusades, Ashkenazi Jews, according to this argument, their culture began to look inward, began to become much more insular, regard the outside world as far more toxic, regard non-Jewish culture as far more dangerous for Jews to engage in, and tend to shut down influences of the outside world. Spanish Jewry, on the other hand, which did not experience the trauma of the First Crusade, continued to be much more open to non-Jewish culture, much more open to using the vernacular. In fact, Shmuel Ibn Nagrela, who I mentioned earlier, he actually wrote love poetry in Arabic. Yehuda Levi similarly wrote love poetry in Arabic. And some of it is actually, you know, pretty 17 plus rated when you look at it, because they were active participants in the wider culture. So my Nachmanides' argument was, you know, you Ashkenazim there a couple hundred years after the First Crusade, this is like dangerous for you because your youth are not trained to acculturate themselves to the outside world, and if they were suddenly to be exposed to Maimonides and by extension to Aristotle, it could be dangerous for their self view and for their Weltanschauung as a whole, and so therefore this ban is really only appropriate for you. But us Sephardim living in Spain, where we're, you know, regularly in commerce with Christians and with Muslims, and we're fluent in three languages easily, you know, for us we don't need this ban. His voice was not heard, and of course the Maimonidean controversy only got worse, but nevertheless he was a voice of calm in those difficult times. Perhaps the most dramatic period of Nachmanides' life is the Disputation of 1263 that occurred in Barcelona. Some half century earlier, a Jew converted to Christianity, his name was Nicholas Donin, and he presented an argument to the, I forget which monks it was, starts with a C. Help me out here, one of the monks. Anyways, he presented an argument to...
Not Pablo Cristiano?
No, not Pablo, I'm talking about Nicholas Donin. Where is Dr. Levy? Starts with a C. Friars.
Capuchin?
Not Capuchin.
Dominicans.
Starts with a C. I knew it. So Dominican monks, he presented this argument that, you know, you've been trying to convert these Jews for so many centuries, 12 in particular, and it hasn't worked. And you know why it hasn't worked? Because they have a secret book that you Dominican friars know not, which is the Talmud. I, a recent convert to Christianity, I know the Talmud backwards and forwards. I know it like the palm of my hand. And I can show you that the Talmud is exactly the reason why the Jews don't convert. That and a steady diet of Chinese food. Those two things, and they will never convert. You have to cut off the supply of Chinese food, and you have to... Okay, so what ended up happening... Thank you. So what ended up happening was that Nicholas Donin organized a formal disputation and with one of the important rabbis of France, and... it didn't go so well for the Jews. It was, and I don't want to take us too much into that particular disputation, but it was left somewhat inconclusive at the end. So 50 years later, another convert to Christianity, a man named Pablo de Cristiani, that was his Christian name obviously, he decided to try again, and he approached essentially the Pope Clement VI, who brought it to King Aragon, the King James I of Aragon, and who insisted that they have a debate on the Talmud. Now, at this point, King James I was actually somewhat friendly with Nachmanides. He was on good terms. And again, this is Spain. This is not France. And James I did not have tremendous enthusiasm for this project at all. But there was a certain struggle between the papacy and the monarchy. And so he ultimately caved and he said, okay, fine, let's do it. But I think we should use this friend of mine, Nachman, who I think will be a pretty good representative of the Jews. There was a certain number of negotiations about how the debate would take place. Nachmanides insisted on freedom of speech. He argued that he would not participate in this at all if he could not say what he needed to, and this was granted to him. Of course, it would later be revoked. But what ended up happening was Pablo de Cristiani took a disastrous strategy in the debate. He specifically said, he argued that the reason why the Jews don't convert is because the Talmud itself has the truth of the coming of the Messiah buried in it, and the Jews, because of their degenerate nature, refuse to believe what is in the Talmud itself. In other words, he wanted to say that you know, the Talmud that you guys study, it itself proclaims the very divinity of our Messiah. That was his argument, which was a disastrously stupid argument because he was going up against a Talmudic master. And when they met in these four debates in the summer of 1263, Nachmanides absolutely destroyed Pablo de Christiani. Among the many arguments he used, for example, there are references to Jesus in the Talmud, quite a few of them. Most of them are rather negative in nature, and I won't list them here. I'm sure that in the YouTube version of this, someone will thankfully provide all of them for the rest of the audience. But when Pablo de Christiani pressed Nachmanides on this, what do you say about these statements? He says, that Jesus? No, that's not the same Jesus that you're talking about. We had lots of Jesuses. There's so many of them. And he said, look, who's the teacher of this Jesus here? Yehoshua ben Prakhe. Well, Yehoshua ben Prakhe lived 200 years later. Can't be the same Jesus. And therefore, you can say what you want, but you're not referring to the right Jesus. Which one is the right Jesus? I don't know. And so in other words, all of Pablo de Christiani's best arguments were very easily deflected by this one single position that Nachmanides took. Fascinatingly, we have both sides of the debate in print. We have the Sefer HaVikuach, which Rabbi Trump will discuss in his portion of the hour. That's Nachmanides' version of the debate. And we also have the Latin transcript of the debate. So we have, because they kept it, you know, they want a copy of it too. And there's lots of overlaps, and there's lots of places where the text was probably altered to protect the innocent, that kind of thing. But we can observe a few really salient ideas about the debate based on its conclusion. The church, of course, won. That was a foregone conclusion. But King James I said, Nachmanides, you did a great job. Here are 300 gold coins, and you better hightail it out of Spain, because you are in so much trouble. You did such an amazing job. You embarrassed the church. You can't stay in the Iberian Peninsula any longer. So anyways, he was kicked out of the Iberian Peninsula. He was forced to leave. It was a very, very tearful departure. Among other things, the legend says that he told all of his followers and his family, some traveled with him, some stayed behind. He told them they didn't know what would happen to him. His plans were to make Aliyah, to move to Israel. And that's quite a different proposition in the 13th century as in the 21st century. They said, we don't know what's going to happen to you. What will be your fate? And he said to them, apparently, that on the day I die, you know, I was very close with my mother, he said, on the day I die, a crack will appear in my mother's gravestone. And according to the legend passed down by Spanish Jewry, that in fact happened, that 4 years later when he passed away, a crack appeared in his mother's tombstone. But we actually don't know exactly when he died or even where he is buried. There are several competing sites for his tomb. He made his way to Israel in 1267, and what he found on arrival was amazing. In Jerusalem, there were only two Jewish residents. And in order to pull together a minyan for the high holidays, they had to canvass the local villages to bring in a minyan. He was absolutely aghast that was the situation in Israel. And so here, already in his 70s, he re-engaged himself and he put himself to the very difficult task of community building. And he single-handedly was able to attract more and more Jewish migrants and eventually to re-establish a Jewish community in Jerusalem and in Israel, in Akko in particular. A quote he writes from one of his letters to his sons, only two brothers live here. Dyers who bought their dye from the governor were joined up to 10 Jews in their home on Sabbaths for prayers. Something about his thought and writings, and that is by way of introduction to my illustrious colleague, Rabbi Trump. He was a huge, very prolific commentator and the author of several standalone tractates. I'm looking at the back room, the back of the wall. I see several volumes of his work right here. He was, unlike Rashi, much more of a Kabbalist, a very strong influence of Iberian Kabbalah. He was also influenced heavily by Maimonides, even though he differed with him on many areas. But he was a systematic theologian. Unlike Rashi, whose main genius is as a commentator, leading you through the text, Ramban was writing monographs. He was writing like books. This is a book on the afterlife. This is a book on the laws of family purity. This is a book on, you know, what we think about good and evil, tzaddik v'ralo, things like that. One of my favorite texts, which actually I spent about a year studying with one of my daughters in preparation for her bas mitzvah many years ago, is the Igeras HaRambam, the letter of the Ramban, which is a letter that he wrote upon his departure to one of his sons. It's a very brief letter, perhaps 500 words in length, and very powerful statements. Essentially, it's a tzava, an ethical will, in which he tells his child, these are the things that are really important to me as a human being, as a Jew. I want you to absorb them, and I want you to emulate them, you and all of your progeny. And this Igeres HaRamban has been associated with a tremendous number of miracles, particularly within the Sephardic tradition, such that it is read ritually by many Jews, Sephardim and Ashkenazim, either once a day or once every 30 days. A good measure of whether or not a siddur is worth buying is check out if it has Igeres HaRamban after Shacharis, because that'll give you a sense of where it's coming from, in my humble opinion. And it's a very short work, very worth reading, and very worth, you know, internalizing. So with that, I'm actually going to stop a few minutes early so we can hear more of the words of the Ramban offered by our glorious colleague, Rabbi Ya'akov Trump.
I want to just start by, first of all, telling everybody what a distinct pleasure it is to be working with Dr. Abramson. You know, not only is Dr. Abramson our favorite dean in residence in this shul, but, you know, and really the genius behind this concept. This is content and context. But so many times in our lives we learn all about the content. And in fact, I think we spend most of our school careers and our adult careers learning a lot about content. But context roots everything. As we're going to be seeing in the next few minutes, as we learn, we'll so much more appreciate exactly what's going on in the Ramban's life and his ideas when we get a sense of where he came from in this most beautiful, succinct description. How can you summarize the Ramban in half an hour? That was the most beautiful description. It is really, you know, being as I do have a presidential name, I can say, you know, think not, O community, what your community can do for you. But what you can do for your community, and Dr. Abramson's really stepped forward, and all of us have so many things we can contribute, and it's so beautiful to be able to contribute with, together with all of you, and led by Dr. Abramson in learning together. This is what we're going to do. Is I'm going to actually work exactly as we plan this together. We're going to work in almost the same format. We're going to take five aspects of the Ramban's life, and we're going to look at five specific sources. So we learned a little bit about the background of the Ramban. Let's hear his words. Let's hear what he said in each of those different five sectors that Dr. Abramson was speaking about so beautifully just a few minutes ago. But before we start, I just want to actually start talking about the importance of learning the Ramban. I want to share with you all what happened to me, my introduction to the Ramban. It was a number of years ago. And I was in Israel, I believe it was in my first year, just at the end of Sukkot on Hashana Rabbah. And I was had the privilege of learning in the yeshiva of Keren B'Yavne. And one of the formative teachers in my life was a person by the name of Rav Bleichman, who many of us know in this community. And he used to host us on Saturday on Hoshana Rabbah night for a long learning session, you know, 3 hours. He used to speak in 3-hour chunks. And you just really walk out there thinking in a different way. And what he said was the most remarkable thing. He said to us, boys, he says, up till now you've learnt about the bones and structure of Judaism. Now's the time to put the meat into the skeleton. And he says, you need to be learning about machshava. You need to be learning about Jewish philosophy. You need to understand why we do what you do. He says, you know what you should do? Is go out right now and buy a Ramban. Learn the words of the Ramban. And so it was. That was my first year. I went to the shuk, was able to get from a bookstore that my Ramban is just there on the table right over there, which I have the schus of doing a 5-year cycle of Ramban on the parasha. And there afterwards, when I had time in YU, there were actually weekly tests on specific Rambans on the parasha, very difficult tests, which I undertook with Masmidim. mass media program at YU. And then a friend of mine and I often nights at YU, what we used to do is we used to just steal 15 minutes to read the Ramban like a book. So we used to go from the beginning, let's start at Genesis and let's read creation in the Ramban's world, rather than even on the parasha, because so many times you miss so many opportunities, where the opportunity are in that experience, going through a little bit of the Ramban on Eov, the Ramban on Shir HaShirim. There is so much, and it has changed my life. There is no way I can tell you how my Judaism looked before and after the engagement with Ramban. So I can't even just tell, I cannot barely tell you how much, I can barely express how much excitement I have for this particular subject. So let's start at the very beginning. What a lot of people will say, and this is an important point, is what is the Ramban doing? Rather than opening up the Mikros Kedolos and, you know, we sort of randomly pull our finger and drop it anywhere on the page and say, oh, that's what so-and-so says. Let's try to understand what they're doing. What's the thesis of the Ramban on the Torah when he takes a look at the Torah? So let's take a look at the first section, which will be Parshanot. What is his methodology? What's he out to do on his Pirush on the five books of the Torah? So he actually, as all good books do, they explain themselves. So here it is. Here, if you take a look, there's actually sheets which went around, which have the sources, and I managed to translate a bunch of them. I did not manage to translate all of them. So we're going to start with some of the translated sources, and this is in his introduction. We're going to look at theory, and we're going to apply it. So listen to what he says. Very fascinating. He starts off very Kabbalistically. He starts talking about the names of Hashem and how they apply in black fire and white fire on the expression of what the Torah is. And then he goes on to say the following. Here's what he's going to do. And I'm going to place to the light of the candelabrum, Pirusha Rebbeinu Shlomo Ateres Tzvi V'Tzfiras Tiferes. Who's going to be in the centerpiece of the glory is the Pirusha Rebbeinu Shlomo. Who's Rebbeinu Shlomo?
Rashi,
which is why we saw Rashi last week, right? So this is the natural segue, of course, into the Ramban. I'm going to give the centerpiece of Rashi, is Rashi. Muchtar B'nimusei HaMikra V'Mishnah V'Gemara. He is crowned, listen to the three parts there, with the sensitivities of the text, of the Mishnah and the Gemara. Lo mishpata b'chora, he has the firstborn share, says the Ramban. B'dvorav again, his words, I'll gaze. B'avo som eshkeh, he's peering through in love. Just listen to the love poetry about Rashi's words here. You can get a better approbation. V'imohem yiyeh lonu masal matan, drisha v'chakira. We're going to have interactions with those words, and we're going to have debates. That's a very, very subtle way of saying he's going to disagree at times. But the point is, the basis is going to be Rashi. I'm going to discuss all his pshatim, whether it be midrash or his pshat. Now, folks, you see, here's one of the problems with translation. You probably didn't realize, but in the Hebrew, it all rhymes. Okay, so a lot of these introductions, the Ibn Ezra, the Ramban, these are rhyming lines. You translate it, you lose it, it all falls flat. But there's a certain cadence to the way this introduction runs, which is why he's using very poetic words. And then he says at the end, this is important to keep in mind, he says, V'im Rabbi Avraham ben Ezra, and regarding the Ibn Ezra, who we're going to deal with in just a few weeks' time, T'yelonu tochachom gule v'ava misutara, or misuteres. I'm going to have, we'll call it explicit rebuke, and implicit love, which means to say, when I'm going to disagree with him, it's going to be in a little more vociferous manner than it would be with Rashi. Okay, so he's laying out what the primary description is over here. Where's his starting point always going to be?
Rashi.
Always Rashi. Who's his counterpoint usually going to be? Ibn Ezra. Okay, so this is going to be the way he's going to do it. What does he love about Rashi? What is it about Rashi that he so loves, he so desires to learn about, is? The fact that he's got the sensitivity to three parts, the text and the Torah Sheba'al Peh. Let's see an expression of that. Let's take a great example right now, right in front of us. Here we have it. So, lost in translation, lost in one of the deepest areas of Bereshis Perek Yud, between the great flood and the dispersion. We have this following description. V'kush yolad es Nimrod, so there's this gentleman called Nimrod is born, who hechel lios gibor ba'aretz. He started to be the strong man in the land. Hu haya gibor tzayid, he was a great hunter, lifnei Hashem, al ken yamer ken Nimrod gibor tzayid lifnei Hashem. Therefore people would always say, you're like a hunter, like Nimrod. What is the Torah talking about over here? What's really going on with Nimrod? You know, positive, negative, neutral, folks. What is going on in this pasuk? So let's see, what's our positive? Positive sounds like?
People.
Lifnei Hashem, it's in front of God, right? Mm-hmm. Sounds like, you know, your name is put in front of God. That sounds very positive. What's potentially negative over here?
Arrogance?
No, there's no word mention of arrogance here, but, are you?
You're putting yourself before
Hashem is put in front of God. Very good, meaning to say he is in front of Hashem. So is that a positive? That could go swing both ways. It could be subservient, or it could be actually putting himself forward. I didn't actually think about it in that perspective. Very fascinating note. Another option over here is the word Sayed. Sayed, what kind of hunter is he? What is he hunting? Who are the victims of his hunting? So this is where the Ramban steps in. Here's a classic Ramban. Let's take a look at the next source over here. So let's take it right from here. He says the following. What's the format again? Starting point is always Rashi. Fantastic. So let's start with Rashi. He says, "Hu haya gibor tzad livnei Hashem, tzad daton shel brios." He would hunt. This was propaganda. He would hunt the minds of people. He wasn't out there in the field of the bow and arrow, says Rashi. He's actually going, and he with his propaganda, he's convincing people of his ideologies. Befiv umaton nimrod b'mokom. What is his ideology? Rebellion against God. Al kain yomer al kol adam marshia ba'azus ponim v'yodei rabbi ribono umiskavin nimrod boy yomer zek nimrod. Therefore, any person in history, well, as what the Pasuk is saying, any individual in history who's going to actively, intentionally rebel against their creator is going to be called a Nimrod. Right? And it's a wonderful biblical name, and some children in Israel still have it today. But at the end of the day, the Pasuk is saying, this is the format, this is the model, this is for a person who actively rebels against God. Because who's he hunting? People. Lifnei Hashem, as I was saying, against God, especially, not in front of God. That is what Rashi has done over here. Why is this of importance in context? What is about to happen in the stage of anthropological development of humankind in Bereshis Perek Yod? We have just finished the flood. What is the next step? The Tower of Babel. And we know that, in fact, Nimrod is heavily involved. So the way Rashi is doing is saying, who was behind the Tower of Babel is Nimrod, because he's the person who said, let's rebel against God. So now he's putting those two parts of context now click into place, and Rashi has said this. And he continues to say, Loshan Rashi, quoting Rashi, V'chein da'as Rabosenu. And Rashi is, in fact, quoting Chazal. So why does he like Rashi? Because Rashi is going with a traditional approach as to how to interpret this pasuk. Good. Contextual idea. Then he goes on to the stage number two. Stage number two, as he always described in his introduction, was Ibn Ezra. So he has Ibn Ezra. The Rabbi Avraham, Pirush Hefech B'inyan HaDerech Pshuta. He went the opposite direction. He went into positive territory. What type of hunting was he doing? Or what did people hunt in those days? Animals. So he was just a very sophisticated hunter, right? Pirush lifnei Hashem. What does it mean before in front of God? Listen to what he says. What else could it mean? If he's not taking people against God, how is a hunter relating to God in front of God? So says Ibn Ezra, as he continues to the end of this paragraph, he says that he was to bring sacrifices. So he'd hunt all these animals, bring them in front of God. So according to the Ibn Ezra, how was Nimrod's polling in front of God? Positive, negative, neutral? Very positive. Nimrod is, in fact, a very outstanding, upstanding leader in the community, according to the way the Ibn Ezra says it. And listen to what the Ramban says. Ve'en dvar of Nirin. No, there's no worth to what the Ibn Ezra says. Hinehu matzdik rasha. He is. He is actually justifying an evil person. Ki rabosenu yodu rishoy bekabolai. Because, what's the reason of the Ramban's rejection? Our rabbis knew via tradition that he was incorrect, that Nimrod is a bad person. This is such an important point. You see what's happened over here? The Ibn Ezra has essentially cleared the deck from any tradition and analyzed the pasuk by itself. He said, well, look, he's a hunter, it's in front of God, maybe the hunting is in front of God, he's bringing these sacrifices to God. Isn't that a wonderful thing? What is he missing? He's missing everything that Rashi added, which is the tradition. We don't just understand the Torah because one day we open up the Torah and analyze it with no context, with no sense of tradition. We have to analyze it going back. We have to go to the Rabboseinu and understand where it comes from. And that's what Rashi was doing. That's the problem that the Ibn Ezra has over here. By the way, this is a very important point over here, just to sort of stop and appreciate what Dr. Abramson said just a few minutes ago. The Ramban does not spare words for people he disagrees with. Okay, so, and it's very clear, and this is why you get so much enjoyment when you read that the transcript of that debate. But more so, the Ramban wrote, this is an opportunity just to footnote and say, if you click the HTML over here, the Ramban wrote many books about people he did not approve of. One example is a book which was written called the Baal HaMa'or. The Baal HaMa'or was a young man who wrote a book, Rav Zerachia Bal Hamaor, who wrote a book on the Rif, Rabbeinu Yitzhak Alfasi. The first halachic codification of the Gemara was written by Rav Yitzhak from Fez. And what happened was is that this young man, Rav Zerachia Alevi, this young upstart in the view of the Ramban, wrote a pirush on the bottom called Bal Hamaor, where he disagreed with the Rif. And the Ramban thought that this was inappropriate. It was inappropriate, some say he was actually 17 years old. It was inappropriate for somebody to be doing such a thing. So what did the Ramban write? He wrote a book which title actually explains the agenda of the book. It was called Milchamas Hashem, the War of God. And the War of God was no less than a War of God, and he spares no words on every single page where he disagrees with Zerachia Bal Halevi in terms much more sophisticated than this. So just this is a point to see that when the Ramban does not spare time for people he disagrees with. Now, this is where we jump into the third section, and with this we'll leave Parshanut. The Ramban says the following, and now he comes back to his own Pirush. Take a look at the next paragraph. Va'nachon be'inai. Here we are. Va'nachon be'inai, that which is good in my eyes. So now the Ramban has moved away from Rashi. He's moved away from the Ibn Ezra, and now he moves into his own realm. He says, Ki hu hechel yos moshel b'gvurosoy al hanashim v'amolech t'chila. In fact, what's it talking about? It's talking about this is the first imperial nation in the world, led by Nimrod. Nimrod, what does it mean, Gibor Chayil? It means to say, Gibor Tzayid, he was the person who in fact now took his will and imposed it on not just the Babylonians, he goes on to describe the Assyrians as well. This was the first country, the first king, the first imperial subjugation in history. Which is fascinating because there's a beautiful essay by Rabbi Jonathan Sacks on Parshas Noach, very well worth reading, in which he quotes Paul Johnson. Paul Johnson, of course, is the author of History of the Jews. And Paul Johnson says that the beauty of Judaism is the ability to be able to balance the community and the individual. The collective and the specific. What's interesting over here is this is exactly what is going on in the Dor HaFlaga, in the Dor HaPalaga, in the generation of dispersion. What was the problem with the generation of dispersion? The way Rabbi Jonathan Sacks argues it is that what does it mean they had one language? It meant to say that one person imposed their rule, their language, on the entire region. There was only one way to live society, details didn't matter. What's the Ramban saying? That's exactly what Nimrod was doing. That's what it means, Gibor Tzayid. But you see what the Ramban has done? He starts off with Rashi. He knows this person's bad. Rashi tells you how is he bad because he used to his propaganda against God. The Ibn Ezra says it's positive, can't be. He takes the same ideology as Rashi. He must be bad, but he now adds a sophisticated wrinkle to it. He's not disagreeing with Rashi, but he's going further in that vein, which is the notion of imperialism and the rise of imperialism. That is a classic Ramban on the Torah. What we're missing in this Ramban is his Al Derech HaEmes, which he'll have at the end, which is Kabbalistic edition. That's in most of the translations the Ramban stopped translating. We do not get this over here. They come up a little later on in the Torah, and certainly in the first chapter of Genesis. Fascinating as a format Ramban. Let's move on. From Parshanut, this is just about methodology. What was he trying to do? Let's move into the next realm that Dr. Abramson talked about mysticism. So he wrote many, many books. And one of the books he wrote is called Torah Sa'adam, the laws of the humanity, of the human. And in it he discusses many halachic aspects of Avelus, which a lot of our Hilchos Avelus are based on his works, as quoted through Shulchan Aruch. But at the end of the book, he's got a section called Shar Hagmul. Shar Hagmul is about the end of days. And in this section, he talks about this world, the hereafter, the revival of the dead, how sins work, how punishment works, different layers and mechanisms of sin. And to me, the first time I had the opportunity of learning this book, it was the first time that there was somebody who synthesized everything. Oftentimes in life, we hear a little Gomorrah here, a little Maimorah there, a little statement over here, and you hear all these different ideas, and you don't really know how they all work together. The Ramban takes everything, puts it into the funnel, and he produces the most magnificent, articulate edifice, which is the Shar HaGmul. Let's take one example over here of what he says. We're not going to do it all inside, but just to get you a sense of the types of issues that he's dealing with over here. He starts off, and this comes back to what Dr. Abramson said again, is his view and regard of the Rambam. Let's take a look at just the first moment for what he starts off by quoting the Rambam, Rav Moses Maimonides. He says, Ma yikroi divrei harav hagadol Rabbi Moshe zichro levracha. So remember, when he quotes Ibn Ezra, it's not on the same level as this. He calls him Rabbi Moshe Zichrono Livracha, right? The Rav HaGadol. And believe me, he disagrees with the Rambam across the Torah. and across his works. But the way he quotes them is with great deference and respect. He says, "Bemilos kitzoros va'arukos." In many short and long instances, the Rambam says, "Shekasa b'zeh olam b'perek chelek." He talks about the last chapter of Sanhedrin, where the Rambam goes into these types of mystical aspects of afterlife. He says, "Omar ki ba'olam haba yaskilu nafshoseinu sham misodos haborek kafi shiaskilu ba'olam hazeh misodos hakachavim agalgalim ha'yoser." In the world to come, we're going to have access to secrets which we don't really fully understand in this world. Why? V'chein omru zal ba'olam haba ein lo achila v'lo ishtia ela tzadikim v'yoshim v'atrosem b'roshem v'nerim izi v'ashkina. The hereafter, says the Rambam, Maimonides, is a place of pure, absolute spiritual nature. There is no physicality whatsoever. It is complete absorption with the divine. This is an Aristotelian concept, which Rambam understood. In fact, he makes note of that at the beginning of the next paragraph, where he says, "Va'od kosa b'tshuva shele," he answers in a response, "Umash yismichu chach sheskimu chach meyovan v'chach me'amarov b'nefesh ha'nefesh tzura b'loy golam u'v'loy guf." He quotes the Greek philosophers who the Rambam was basing his philosophy on, in certain regards, who said that the soul, the person is really a soul without a body. And this influences a lot of the Rambam's ideology and a lot of the disputes he will have with the Ramban himself. So the Rambam will talk about times where, for example, where in Parshas Vayera, where it says that Avraham Avinu goes out to meet three angels, the Rambam actually will argue that he never ran out to meet three angels. He was in his bed having a dream, and in his dream he saw three angels, because physical bodies cannot interact with spiritual beings, because there's no correlation between the two of them. Right? The fight with the angel at night was not a fight with the angel at night. Yaakov Avinu was in a horizontal position the entire time. He was fighting where? In his dreams. And the Ramban to each time takes the Rambam to task. This is an example of where he does it. To conclude, in the Ramban himself, he says, where he closes, he says, referring to the last argument of the Rambam believes that as a person dies after this world, they immediately enter into Olam Haba, the next world. The Rambam says, absolutely not. It is not true. Elo areyu motzui v'omeid. A person waits. Kamoi shenemar asher tzafanta pulasecho. V'loi kora'u Olam Haba. So he says that in fact, when a person dies, there's a waiting period. Olam Haba is a future destination for all of humanity to enter into, rejoined body and soul. Both the body and soul have to go a process of cleaning or clarification. They're reunited in entering Olam Haba, according to the Ramban. And that is the predominant philosophy which we adopt based on the Ramban's idea, as opposed to Rambam, who says immediately after death, there's a spiritual realm that the soul enters and the body is never rejoining it, which is a completely different way of philosophy. Here is where the Ramban actually talks about it. There's so much more to talk about, but this gives you just a taste of the types of things that, far from trying to understand words in Tanakh, far from trying to understand the halachas of Avelus, the Ramban is talking about the very underpinnings and the foundations of our faith. Let's take it to the next level. Moving away from mysticism, moving away from Parshanut, let's enter into the debate itself. This, as Dr. Abramson described, was a very big watershed moment, of course, in the Ramban's life, in the Barcelona Disputation under the King of Aragon. I think it's worthwhile just taking a very brief look at the actual words he uses to describe his transcript. I mean, the Ramban writes down for the sake of posterity, and it has worked because we're still reading it. I doubt there's as many people reading the Latin transcript as they are reading the Vikuach HaRamban, and the Ramban says the following. Listen to how he describes it. He is addressing a real issue, and that is why it was that there were not so many willing Jews willing to dispute. So he says the following. Tziva osi Adonenu HaMelech, the king of Aragon, King James, commanded me Lesvakeach im Fry Paul. He asked me to have a dispute with Fry Paul, Be'echoloi, in his palace, Befonov, in front of him, Befnei Yoatzov, Barcelona, in front of his advisors in Barcelona. By the way, we should just take a moment just to appreciate what's going on. We're reading the contours of, it's like we're there. Think about this. So sort of ride back in the Ramban's world. This is not history talking. This is the man himself talking about as he ascends the steps of the castle of Barcelona. He says the following, Vo'an vo'amar. What did I say to the king? So the king sent me a subpoena. What do you do when a king sends you a subpoena? In those days, it wasn't like avoiding jury duty, and there's fines. We're talking about this is capital punishment. What do you do over here? So this is the following. V'an v'omar es ekmitzos adonai hamelech im titni lirushus ledaber kirsoni v'ani mevakesh bo ze rushus hamelech rushus fry rimon defino the port and v'chaver of asher b'kan. He says, I want carte blanche. Says the Ramban, you want to bring me into the place of debate? Allow me to say what I want to say. Allow me to say what I want to say and don't penalize me for saying it. The Ramban was very clever. He realized he couldn't win. He knew there was no way out. He says, but at least allow me to say what I'm about to say. All debates that had happened previously were in fact choreographed. There was nothing that the person could say because should they reinterpret the Bible in the correct way, they were in fact mercilessly killed on the spot or tortured for sacrilegiously misinterpreting the Bible in the debate. So says the Ramban, I want the carte blanche. So here's one example, and this is such a powerful example. Let's take a look at the next part in the debate. This is part of his transcript. We're not going to do the whole thing. Let's just focus on this for the moment. So here's Fry Paul. Amar Fry Paul, V'tamin Sheba, do you believe the Messiah has arrived? Most of the debate focuses around whether, in fact, the Messiah has arrived, whether we're in the idyllic stages of post-Jesus world of the coming. So says the Ramban, Amarti, no, sorry, nope, Aval ani ma'amin v'yodeya, I believe, and listen to what he adds, I don't just believe, I know, sheloi bo v'loi hoya adam me'olam sh'amar. In fact, I know that he did not believe. And there was no person, and there's nobody else besides Yeshu who was called as coming. I cannot believe in his being the Messiah. I'll tell you why, for two reasons. Okay? Now, by the way, this is his carte blanche. Okay, he is digging so deep. You can imagine at this point in time the Dominican priests, you know, shuffling in their shoes at this point in time, as he is about he's about to say. Okay, this is real time now. Shanavi Omer b'Mashiach, the prophet says about the Messiah, Umashloim Mayim Ad Yom Minahar Araf Se'aretz. He's going to control the world from coast to coast. And this individual you're talking about never had such control. He spent a terribly forlorn life being pursued by his enemies. Hiding from his persecutors. In the end, he did not make it. He was crucified. If he couldn't save himself, how could he save the world? Can you imagine this? In the castle in Barcelona, in front of the Dominican friars. And he goes on. Number two, says the Ramban. When the Ramban doesn't mince his words, he does not mince his words. He says the following. Even when he died, his followers weren't celebrated. They didn't have an empire. Rome's success, Constantine in the year 300, was not as a function of Christianity. In fact, the rise of Rome was before Christianity took it over. And after Constantine took over the Roman Empire and split and slowly went to found its demise after Christianity took it over. So you're telling me this is the Messiah? Look at Europe. Look at the Middle East. Who's in control? The children of Muhammad, not Yeshu, says the Ramban. He says, Yirmiyahu talks about the Messiah. He says, there's going to be a time where everybody knows God. And he says, Omer in Yeshaya, ki malah ha'aretz deya es Hashem kamayim le'yam ha'chasim. It's going to be a time where there's going to be so much knowledge of God. It'll be like a sea of knowledge which will cover everybody. V'omer, and it says in Yeshaya as well, the words which are etched into stone outside the buildings of the UN. That you'll take your swords and turn them into plowshares and war will end and cease to be in the world. And war will never proliferate again in the world. He says, look at the blood of the world from the time he died till now. Look at the destruction. He says, in fact, the Christians are responsible for more bloodshed than any other nation. He says, and you, King James, would it be a good thing for you if there weren't wars? This is what the Ramban says in the palace. He says, how could the Messiah have come if this is the state of international affairs and things have not changed? This is what the Ramban says. You just see the power. Can you imagine? I sometimes dream of having the opportunity, even just 5 minutes, to meet the Ramban. I dream of it. Just being able to bask in his glory. And we slowly get to the sense of who he really is. But just imagine 5 minutes in the presence of somebody like this. Let's go a step further. We're going to follow two more ideas. We're just a little pressed for time. Personal growth. You know, a lot of times when you come into the world of academia, as Dr. Abramson will tell you, academics don't necessarily translate seamlessly into the world of action, necessarily. And that's why, as Dr. Abramson said, when one looks at the Igeres HaRamban, the letter he said to his son, it is the moment where you see the giant become human. Listen to what he says, and there's so many, every line is replete with messages and lessons of life, but he says the following. Let's just look at three lines. He says, Vehevi Zahir. He says, my son, be very careful. Likrois ba Torah tamid, asher tuchal lakaima. Learn Torah in order to actually do it, to live it. Vakasher takum in asefer. As you finish pondering, as you finish philosophizing, as you finish learning, apply it. You learn about attributes of humanity. You learn about characteristics. You learn about tort damages when you go into the legal framework of the Gemara. How do you apply that? Does it remain in your head? Does it remain a legal fiction? Does it remain something which you talked about in the Beis Medrash and your life is led very differently outside those walls? Says the Ramban, my son, I want you to be the kind of person who doesn't just learn Torah, but a person who lives Torah. And over here you see this is a departure from just the miraculous giant in the mind he was, because obviously this is the person who also lived it. One extra point, he says, make sure you have a little diary. Every morning, every evening, just pull it out and just make sure you got an accounting. Like you have an accounting with your company's business and you're making sure every the checks and balances are all there. What about your life? How many times did you shout at somebody? How many times did you transgress something? Did you go over a red line? How many times did you do the right thing? He doesn't keep an accounting of that. This is a person who doesn't just learn. This is a person who lives Torah. That's a transformation I think is important to realize through the countless books that he has. And finally, one last idea. Let's return to perhaps the last and most troubling and trial of the Ramban, which was when he moved to the land of Israel. This piece over here that we're about to read and we're about to learn is so moving, is so transformative, that I think that, you know, just for coming just to hear in this segment, just to hear this part is worth it. The Ramban arrives, as Dr. Abram says, in Israel, and he finds a very impoverished and unstructured community which he tries to reconstruct. In fact, this is a picture in the 1800s, if I'm not mistaken, or the early 1900s, looking in the Chur of a Shul in Jerusalem. But as we know, that just before it, next to the minaret, is underneath there, where there's four columns, is a shul, which is attributed to the Ramban. He talks about four pillars down the middle. And in fact, there's a base medrash there, and there's minyanim all the time for those of us who have opportunity of going. It's the only minaret in the Jewish quarter. And just underneath it, before you get to the churva, which is built Baruch Hashem, this is the previous churva, there is the Ramban's shul, which is allegedly where he gathered his minyanim on those Shabbos. And it's sometimes, maybe the next time we're in Israel, it might be a moment just to go there and pull off the shelf a Ramban and learn the Ramban in the Ramban's shul in his full place. But let's go further. So he talks about in his arrival in Israel, he talks about his arrival in the ancient city of Akko. So here's Akko on the north coast. It's a city which has got much history, biblical history, and of course contemporary history today. And the Ramban says the following. He has a footnote from his arrival in the land of Israel, and he says the following. Listen to what he says. The intellectual honesty of this is most remarkable. And there's a few pieces like this. You cannot find this in the regular Ramban. It's added as an addition, and sometimes in Kisisa, in one of the Mossad Rav Kook printings, and it's in his letters, additions from when he arrived in Israel. He says the following: Berchani Hashem ad koi shezachisi uvasi la'akol. Baruch Hashem, I arrived in the city of Akol. I found a silver coin which was written with inscriptions, engravings on it. On the one side it looked like a stick which was flowering, on the other side it looked like a bowl of sorts. And around it was this writing which was very clearly engraved. Take a look at this. This is the coin the Ramban's talking about, right? So we talk about the stick which is flowering, we talk about this bowl over here. And then there's inscriptions. Now, let's try to appreciate. One second. I just want to get to the end of this point. The Ramban talks about this over here, and the problem is that both he and us look at these blankly. What does it say? And we don't know. Why did he not know? And why do we not know what it says around it? Because this is Ksav Ivri, this is Akkadian. Okay? This is written in the Ksav Ivri, the original, not the Ksav Oshri, but the original dispute as to the development of this, the original letters of Hebrew, which are written in the following way. So he says the following, let's come back for a second to here we are. He says, V'heru ha'kos of likutiyim v'koro miyad. I gave it to one of the Kutiyim, one of the Akkadians who lived around there, and he immediately read it, because of course he could read the Ugaritic like Semitic language. He says the following: Kihu ksav ivri asher nishar lakutiyim kumay shemuzkar b'Sanhedrin, as the Gemara in Sanhedrin Daf Chav says it. V'koro min atzada echot shekel hashkolim. The one inscription says this is a shekel of the shkolim. This is an ancient shekel used in the times of the Beis Hamikdash. Mitzad hashen Yerushalayim HaKadosha. The other side was written in the inscription was Jerusalem, the holy city. The one side is the staff of Aaron, which sprouted forth those beautiful flowers. And the other was the bowl that contained the manna, which was allegedly left in the Kodesh Kodashim, as the Gemara describes it. So what's the first thing the Ramban does? We weighed it. How much does the shekel weigh? You're holding history in your hand. How much silver does it weigh? It weighs a particular type of silver. And it's chatzi ukia, which is like what Rabbeinu Shlomo says. Who's Rabbeinu Shlomo? Full circle, Rashi. There was a dispute between the Ramban and Rashi, how much a shekel weighed. And he gets to Akko and he weighs it, and it weighs how much like? Whose side of the debate? Like Rashi. We understand? It's all been theory. He's been living in Spain up till now. Now for the first time in history, he's able to see it. And he weighs it and is like Rashi. So what would you expect him to say now? What's the next sentence? What would the Ramban say at this point in time in his life? Rashi. So at this point in time, he could either have not written it down. He could either he sort of excused this from his thesis because it didn't fit with his natural work, which he's spent a long time working on. But that's clearly not what he did. Or on the other hand, he could say, hands down, Rashi beat me. Listen to the sensitivity of his words. And he quotes on the another coin he found like that. He says, Nistayu divrei Rabbeinu Shlomo siyo gadol. Rabbeinu Shlomo, Rashi, has an incredible support from this. Listen to the sensitivity. Here's a man who's looking at archaeological real digs. He's looking at archaeology. Is it absolute proof? No. He doesn't say Rashi's right. He says Rashi has got an incredible support, an incredible proof. Why? Because Ramban also has the sensitivity to realize this may not be the only shekel. And in fact, for years afterwards, many other shekelim of different weights were found that were used at different times. So the Ramban, on the one hand, and one of my teachers, Rabbi Chaim Angel, points to this Ramban as the most incredible integrity and honesty of the Ramban. I know, he says on the one hand, that I'm wrong. It wasn't what I said. But on the other hand, it's not absolute truth. I'm able to be able to actually come to the land of Israel, appreciate what I'm seeing, what I'm feeling, and to adapt my whole life work, even at his old age, to be able to include this. This is what this is really an astounding piece over here of history and Parshanut coming together. What we did, what the opportunity of doing was we looked at Parshanut a little bit of the Ramban, his methodology, his mysticism in the world of the hereafter, his disputation in Barcelona, the transcendence of that from the world of the mind to the heart, and finally how that applied when he talks about the land of Israel. I hope this is a drop in the beginning of our exploration in what is a transformative experience of learning the Ramban. Looking forward to next week, ladies and gentlemen.